Hey, Kara, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Good. Is it sharing the screen, the title page?
Yep.
Good.
I don't see your screen yet.
What's that?
I don't see your screen yet. I have mine. It just looks like a black screen. And there we go. Yep.
Why is it doing that? There, is that right? Full screen?
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you want to test the audio?
See what? Oh, I see. It's actually doing a show where I want to pause that slide.
Yeah,
you guys are all going on mute.
Is at the bottom and it
You want to test the audio?
No, I have it. I did that the other day. Thank you.
Your haircut looks nice, John.
Back on mute.
Instead of putting you back on mute.
Hello, John.
Hey, Phil, how are you?
I'm well, thank you. Thank you.
Screen to you.
Yeah.
Maybe not.
I can hear you, buddy. There we go.
And watch her hit golf balls. Let's take a look at our honesty. Entering this fourth event of the season.
Thank you.
Are we there?
That's it.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming. I think we'll just wait a few minutes for those stragglers to arrive.
That's what I was trying to do.
Well, thank you very much for joining us to celebrate the life of Mary Eileen Morris Fisher, our mom. Today would have been her 72nd birthday. We certainly wish we could be together in person. If there was ever a time for a lot of hugs, tonight would have been nice. In the absence of that, know that John and I feel your care, support, and love, and we are grateful. John and I will speak, and then we'll play a wonderful slideshow video John has prepared. We have put you all on mute. When we planned my dad's memorial, my mom repeatedly said that she didn't want to have an open mic part. That may have just been her commentary on the crowd that she expected for that event, as opposed to any judgment of all of you. But we thought the Zoom that mute would work best here. We do have the chat function available and encourage you to participate there if you like. John and I wanted to share some memories and thoughts to memorialize our mom and to also show you that we are doing okay. There's no finer tribute to our mom and to our dad, and to what they did as parents, to show that despite our incredibly difficult journey of loss and grief these past few years, John and I have not lost our calm, thoughtfulness, optimism, humor, and gratitude. But honesty was also an essential part of our upbringing. And to be honest, John and I are only at times doing okay. We now live with this tough, horrible cancer, which is feelings of shock, sadness, exhaustion, numbness, exasperation, resentment, loss, and grief. And it has left me angry, frustrated, envious, and bitter. Regretfully, I've acted in ways and reacted in all the ways my mom wouldn't have. After my dad passed away, my mom told me that she hoped to make it through that loss with grace and dignity. It's funny to think that she thought she had to aspire to handle life's difficult challenges with grace and dignity, or that she would ever act in any way that seemed crude or dishonorable, or that she wasn't entitled to. I mean, I'm literally on the edge of just crossing over into outright cussing for about 5 minutes straight in despair over this. But at any rate, even in the midst of that tragic loss, she knew that more than ever, she had to try to maintain her calm, thoughtful, optimistic, humorous, and grateful approach to life. About 3.5 weeks after my dad passed away, my son turned 5. A week or so later, my mom came to Tucson for my son's birthday party. We certainly felt my father's absence. My mom and I were emotional at many points that weekend. Around that time, again, age 5, I was introducing my son to rock and roll music. Of course, we started with the king, Elvis Presley. We worked our way through his hits, and that weekend, we had Return to Sender on regular rotation. That weekend, we actually went to the local 50s diner for dinner one night, and my son asked the DJ to play Return to Sender, which was well received and enjoyed by all. A week or two later, my mom was back in LA, and I talked to her, and she told me about a tough day that she had had. She had picked up some documents related to my father's passing or estate, and she was struggling a little bit. But as she drove home, Return to Sender came on the radio. She said she turned it up and sang as loud as she could, and she felt much better. I know many of you have had the same experience that John and I have had in trying to fully capture her character in words. It feels like our vocabulary isn't enough to get it just right. Stated another way, it just doesn't seem right to call a teacher very, very, very considerate or very, very, very empathetic and so on. But just using the words alone just doesn't seem to really do justice to how she lived and what she did for all of us. She seemed to be the purest form of those traits, certainly beyond what I know of those traits or what I could even envision in living those traits. It's easy to think of traits she never demonstrated. She was never mean-spirited, bitter, jealous, unkind. But if I had to try to capture it in one word, I would say she was heartfelt. She was brilliant. She was caring. She was loyal. She was dependable. She was funny. Everything she did in this life was heartfelt. She loved to be a teacher, and she loved to garden. She liked the planning, the preparing, the reward of patience, and the effort to focus and get your hands on, provide the ideal nutrient setting and encouragement to then be able to sit back and enjoy watching something or somebody grow and develop into its best self. In 2008, she was honored as Chadwick School's Educator of the Year. The headmaster quoted the founder's description of a great teacher. Said, "Teachers with the love of children in their heart, teachers who are eager searchers of truth, teachers who are willing to share their longer experience with children and at the same time are able to learn from the naturalness and sincerity of their pupils." It's a pretty good description. I also like, as many of you have said to us in your notes to us, if she had been my third grade teacher, I would have been a better person. I like to think that spending time with her was like walking through a garden of thoughtfulness. You would sort of casually stroll, and then take turns describing a story of thoughtfulness. You would share sort of the wonder and joy and appreciation of somebody caring for somebody else, or somebody doing something kind for somebody else, or some unexpected joy that came your way. I'll never forget, after my discovery of my mom's brain cancer last summer, we had our first appointment with a cancer doctor after we had learned all this, and it was my mom's oncologist. John and his care were there with my mom, and I was on speakerphone. At that time, we were so anxious and so desperate for some time frame prognosis. In other words, we wanted to understand how much time we might have left with our mom and what that time might look like for her and for us. After we got escorted into the doctor's office, we had to wait a few minutes for the doctor to join us. It was intense, waiting and wondering for what we might hear in this important moment. And as we sat there, my mom told us that she had heard about how that medical practice would pay for any of its staff to complete education or to get higher education. And she smiled warmly at that wonderful, thoughtful idea, even in this very intense, important moment. As we work with this tragic loss, of course, what helps the most is gratitude. I feel so incredibly grateful that she was my mom. I was the luckiest kid in the world to grow up with her as my mom. She gave us her very best. We learned and knew this amazing vision of the world and life. Why would we ever be unkind to someone when there's this great big world full of places and people and stories to enjoy? You knew her, you loved her, and being her son was as wonderful as you could ever imagine. It was the little things, the big things, everything. She would have known exactly what to say to comfort me after I gave myself this not ideal pandemic haircut. Yes, I've been giving myself haircuts at home with clippers I bought, and I did all right until this last one. I went a little too short. I have to take it all short. But she would say, I appreciate that you tried to look nice for this. For that, and for the much, much bigger things, she was always there. I knew that I could call anytime. She would give me her full attention and provide calm, supportive empathy and love. She was the original chicken soup for the soul. That comfort that she could provide was so meaningful for me throughout my life, and the absence of that has been devastating. When I was in first, maybe second grade, I was in a week-long soccer camp at Rolling Hills Country Day. There were a lot of smaller groups and a larger sort of camp. I was on the younger side for the overall camp. The night before the final day of our camp, there was a sleepover on the soccer field. We all brought our sleeping bags and a change of clothes and set up camp in smaller groups on the field. They served pizza, and I think we watched a movie on a big screen. And then they let the kids run around for about an hour before bed. It was predictably chaotic, and all the kids just threw energy at each other. I stayed in our group's little area with our group leader, camp counselor, and my mom had packed some snacks for me, beef jerky and rice cakes. Initially, I didn't think I would need or want them, but at that moment, they were nice to have. Stayed in that area, and I was having a snack with the counselor. A few of the other younger kids took a break from sort of energy and the chaos, the madness out there, and came back to our area. They were a little bit rattled. The counselor asked if I could share my snacks with them. Being my mom's son, I said, of course. And I shared the snacks, and I remember seeing the other kids feeling comforted and calmed as we shared those snacks. And that moment stuck with me throughout my life. I'll never forget what that was like. First, I noted that my mother was always prepared and planned ahead, thought ahead to provide that for me. And I know how lucky I was that that's how she was. And then second, I saw how I could help comfort the other kids in sharing those snacks. It was just like my mom. She thought about and tried to do things that helped each and all of us make it through this world, particularly when we feel a little bit scared. When John and I were younger, my mom used to take us to the Morris family reunions in the summer, which were held in the Pacific Northwest. Could have flown, but we would have missed all the things we could see along the way. We always drove up the coast in our green Volvo station wagon. I have the fondest memories of those drives, the experience of traveling and exploring that way, as well as all the experiences we had along the way. One year we drove across the Golden Gate Bridge. We went to Crater Lake, which is spectacular. And I have the greatest memory of walking through the parking lot and to our car in the late afternoon sun after visiting the water park in Redding, California. It was a beautiful summer day. The sun was just starting to set on the western slope. I felt a little sunburnt and tired, and yet so fulfilled. I was finishing a red slushie in a styrofoam cup as I walked, and I just knew and felt that it had been a great day there. If you heard that one of my fondest memories is going to the water park in Redding, California, it might encourage me to get out a little bit more. But in our family, we always found the best in the simple but rich pleasures in life. I know some of you have enjoyed day trips with my mom to the small, lesser-known museums in LA. And as many of you know, my parents had the greatest joy in inviting friends to their house, cooking meals for their guests, offering them drinks, and encouraging them to sit and enjoy the view of the Pacific Ocean. I'm grateful that my mom and my parents showed me the joy you can just have in the simple experiences and pleasures in our life. My mom paid attention to her community. She loved starting her mornings by reading the paper start to finish. We talked about current events, past examples of vision and character. We scoffed at politics, couldn't get enough of leadership. Chadwick, John, and I were given awards that recognized citizenship and character. If there was anyone who ever thought I was a good citizen in my community, or I had demonstrated good character, it was due to my mom. My dad was the investigator, the prosecutor, and the judge of John and I's character. But my mom was the inspiration and example for us to follow with that behavior. What is especially tragic about her passing is that she was just getting to be a grandmother. She was just built to be a grandmother. I have the fondest memories of Terminal 1 at LAX. I know it makes no sense to those of you who've ever been there. But my family would fly over on Southwest. We would take the escalator down to the ground floor where the baggage is and meet my mom there. She and my kids would delight in seeing each other, and I would end up having to carry multiple bags so that my kids and my mom could walk hand in hand to our car parked across the street. As those of you who've been there know, that ground level is grimy, noisy, congested, and I worried about us crossing safely without getting hit. But I have the most wonderful memories of the joy that I saw in my mom and my kids' eyes when we first got together, we spent time together. Many of you know the story, but my mom turned 70 in 2018. It was about a year after my dad had passed. And our family talked about going somewhere on a special trip together. We considered a couple different ideas and then settled on one place, which was my mom's suggestion. As she said, when some people turn 70, they travel to Europe, and they visit and dine in the fanciest and oldest, most historic castles they can find. Us, we enjoyed the all-you-can-eat complimentary breakfast at the castle-themed hotel at Legoland. The reason that we ended up at Legoland was simple. My mom thought that her grandkids would love it, and they would have the best memories going on that trip there. So we ended up all staying at the castle-themed hotel at Legoland, having a wonderful trip that our kids still do remember to this day. She took us to Disneyland many times. In October of 2017, about 8 months after my dad had passed, my family flew over to LA, and with my mom, we went to Disneyland for a couple of days. We actually stayed at the Disneyland Hotel. And my daughter was 3.5 at that time. And so our focus for her experience was character experiences, where we would take her around and wait in line so that she could meet and have a picture with some of the Disney characters. Got up, got into the park as soon as we could one morning and started trying to get her all the character experiences we could. Started out with Anna and Elsa from Frozen, which was her favorite at that time. And yet my daughter was a little nervous or a little shy just with these characters. We forget that it can be a little emotionally overwhelming for the young children, particularly when the adults are trying to hype it up or very excited about it. So my daughter was sort of slowly, calmly, but a little nervously sort of going through these character experiences until we got to one. I had a special Disney credit card, and so we were able to go for a special sort of behind the scenes visit with one character. And it turned out to be Daisy Duck. And let's see if John can put up the photo now. This is my daughter, who finally delighted in fully embraced going to see or giving a hug to Daisy Duck. And this was a big moment. You can see in the background, my wife is trying to capture her on video. And you can see in the background my mom's look of pure joy that this moment was happening. Those are the memories that I'll take from my mom, just her pure joy, somebody that she cared about, having fun, feeling good, or doing something really special. My mom was no stranger to tragic losses in her life. She had many tough, what seemed unfair losses. But she didn't let the pain of those harden her heart. Instead, she allowed it to soften her heart more than anyone else I met. After experiencing challenging, painful experiences, she used that and focused that. When somebody else might be feeling in that suffering, she did her best to provide care, comfort, attention, empathy, as much as she could. John and I are grateful that you're here with us tonight. And John and I are grateful for all of your care, support, and love that you've given us. Thank you very much again for joining us tonight.
Thanks, Rob. That was wonderful. And as always, a tough act to follow. So bear with me as I deal with technology and get ready. But again, good evening, and thank you again for joining us. We certainly wish that we could see you in person, but we're pleased that technology has allowed us the opportunity to come together tonight to celebrate my mother's life. Together, that means something at a time like this. Recently, I heard a poignant saying that has helped me understand the importance of being together. I heard that there's something worse than being sad, and that is being sad and alone. And thinking about the number of people logging onto Zoom tonight, the number of people who have supported us over the last several months, the cards, the phone calls, the emails. Well, we certainly don't feel alone. Thank you for your love and support. So as an initial note, I've really struggled with what to say tonight. I've stared at an empty screen for weeks while thinking about this, which is unlike me, the son of a teacher and a lawyer. Of course, I was also distracted during this time by the Oprah interview of Meghan and Harry, but I can blame my mother for that because royal watching is definitely a genetic trait. But anyway, then it hit me. It's hard to highlight the qualities of someone who always thought of others first. Mom never liked or sought out attention. Trying to shine a spotlight on such a selfless person was creating this writer's block. And as a side note, many of you will remember that I did not struggle coming up with words for my father. So while I was struggling with what to say, we came across a plaque of my mother's. It was dated November 1966, which was when she was in high school, and it's called the Optimist Creed. And if you'll bear with me for 1 second, I will put it on the screen. I hope that's showing. But as you can see, the plaque reads, "Promise yourself to be so strong that nothing can disturb your peace of mind, to talk health, happiness, and prosperity to every person that you meet, to make all your friends feel that there is something special in them, to look at the sunny side of everything and make your optimism come true, to think only of the best, to work only for the best, and expect only the best, to be just as enthusiastic about the success of others as you are about your own, to forget the mistakes of the past and press on to the greater achievements of the future, to wear a cheerful countenance at all times and give every living creature you meet a smile, to give so much time to the improvement of others that you have no time to criticize others, to be too large for worry, too noble for anger, too strong for fear, and too happy to permit the presence of trouble." Wow, even in reading this again and again, I'm struck by how perfectly it describes my mother. In one of the first drafts of this eulogy, I tried to describe her consistency and integrity. And then we found this plaque that she saved from when she was 17 years old and it perfectly describes how she led her life for the next 54 years. So talk about consistency and integrity. I mean, I feel like I have wobbled and swerved more this evening already than she did over the 54 years of her life since she created this plaque. There are a few particular passages on the plaque that I want to expand on. First, to make all your friends feel that there is something in them. What an incredible way to describe my mother's supportive and wonderful friendship. We have heard from so many people about the way my mother made them feel so valued as friends and colleagues. One friend put it eloquently to us. She wrote, "I'm sure others have told you about your mother's inclusive ways, her sense of humor, her soft voice, her teaching prowess. I always marveled that she never raised her voice. There was a calmness about her that transferred to those around her, especially her students. She had the qualities you want in a friend. Everyone wanted to be Mary's friend, someone whose advice you could trust. She found creative ways to connect with others. She could always find something to talk about with a new friend or an old one. If her bright smile didn't win you over, her thoughtfulness did." That is perfectly said. Mom made people feel valued, feel special, feel unique. It's no wonder that people, everyone from students to colleagues to parents, enjoyed being around Mom. I look back at the Chadwick yearbook from 2009 when they dedicated a portion of it to Mom. The dedication read, "Everyone in school admires Mrs. Fisher, not only as a teacher, but also as a friend. She is always there to catch us when we fall and to help us get back up and running. She has impacted all of her students throughout her journey through childhood and more broadly their lives. Every day she greets us with a warm smile and twinkling eyes, always managing to brighten our day. She is absolutely wonderful and always imaginable, and she never fails to make each and every one of us welcome in her classroom." I enjoyed reading that so much. It captures the genuinely magical quality of my mom's to make everyone feel as if they are special, as if they had something in them. The next passage from the plaque that I want to highlight is, "To be just as enthusiastic about the success of others as you are about your own." Everyone on this call can describe a moment when Mom celebrated one of their successes with complete happiness and joy. I still vividly recall her huge smile and her elation when I looked up at her in the stands 30 years ago after hitting my only home run in Little League. Countless students could describe her enthusiasm and recall her happiness from their personal and academic triumphs. So many friends can remember those moments when Mom reached them and lifted them up at the exact right moments. We're all lucky to have so many pleasant and wonderful memories of her smiles and happiness and her loving support. Another way that I think about this is how focused Mom was on the welfare of others. The plaque put this perfectly too. To give so much time to the improvement of others that you have no time to criticize others. This is another perfect description of my mother as a teacher, as a parent, and as a friend. Of course, she was always so selflessly devoted to others. We all remember that part. One example that is still vivid in my mind is from 2010. Carrie and I were newly married, and Carrie suffered a broken thumb in an accident. I was scrambling to get her to the ER and take care of her. It was a touch chaotic. I was feeling a little overwhelmed. And at the hospital, I looked up, and there was Mom. She was present, calm, and ready to help us through things. Without any request and without asking, she dropped what she was doing and showed up to help us out. Her calm demeanor and steady guidance helped us out immediately. Mom always showed up. Countless times, Carrie and I would return home from traveling, which was often hectic, particularly with our young children, and we would come home to a fridge that was full of fresh foods and fresh milk and would help us start the week. It's impossible to overstate how comforting this was, that she was always thinking of us. In a broader point, this concept also goes to my mother's way of making good things happen. Mom taught and guided people with gentle suggestions, quiet actions, and thoughtful questions, and never criticism. A good friend wrote this after Mom passed. "Your mother was a warm, kind, unique woman who made wonderful things happen quietly and gracefully." This says it so well. When I think about how effective Mom was at making magical things happen, that is the lesson. Guide others to find a new path rather than pushing them one way or another. Lastly, for myself, and for all of us that miss her so much, I want to think about this last point. To be too large for worry, too noble for anger, too strong for fear, and too happy to permit the presence of trouble. When I read this, I think of the end of my mother's life, when the awful cancer had confined her to bed, limited her mobility, and reduced her communication to a few smiles and head nods. During those days, my son Danny, 4 years old at the time, would often run into the room, create a little chaos, and pound on the keyboard of the computer. Without fail, one of us in the room would look at the computer screen and comment to Danny that he had typed out something along the lines of, "I sure do love Barbie dolls," and Danny would get all flustered and strenuously object. And every time, Mom would chuckle from her hospital bed. She was, indeed, too large for worry, too noble for anger, too strong for fear, and too happy to permit the presence of trouble. In fact, when I think of her painful journey with glioblastoma, I can't think of a single time that she complained or gave into worry, anger, or fear. Cancer may have taken her life, but it did not touch her attitude, her love for life, or her outlook. Her strength and happiness were such a gift to us as we tried to support her through illness. What a lesson. Even to her last days, she was a teacher, a leader, and an example. Thank you, Mom. We love you. And now, if you'll permit me, I'll transition to the slideshow that we have created with pictures from family and friends, along with a few other remembrances. Please bear with me as I get this going. Share sound.
Sit with folded hands and become blind. take you in, feed your friends. Her open arms are welcoming. She'll rub your back all night when you're crying. She'll listen to you tell your story, hold your fear and all your worries, help you find the truth when they're all lying. Even when it's hopeless, she keeps trying. She's your mother, you love her. There won't be another place like her again you call home. She stands here to help you. There's nothing she won't do. As long as she's alive, you're not alone. You've got each other. That's your mother. She fixes all the broken things. When you're in love, she's got a ring to give to you. She hopes you give away. She don't care who you give it to, where they're from, if they pray like you. As long as they are good to you, that's enough. First thing she taught you was love is love. She's your mother, you love her. There won't be another place like her again that you call home. She stands here to help you. There's nothing she won't do. As long as she's alive, you're not alone. You've got each other. That's your mother. When you fail her, when you're afraid, crying in the careless mess you've made, she'll make you clean it up yourself and offer you a little help and dry your weary eyes when you let her. But she'll look at you and know you can do better. She's your mother, you love her. There won't be another place like her again that you call home. She stands here to help you. There's nothing she won't do. As long as she's alive, you're not alone. Secrets in your heart, she's always known. She's a beacon, a harbor, a lighthouse, her armor, a promise and a blanket when it's colder.
As we sail into the mystic, hark, now hear the sailors cry. Smell the sea and feel the sky. Let your soul and spirit fly into the mystic. Where that foghorn blows, I will be coming home. Yeah, when the foghorn blows, I wanna hear it. I don't the bowl. And magnificently we will fold into the misty you know I will be coming home. Yeah, when that foghorn whistle blows, I gotta hear it. I don't have to fear it at all.
Thank you for joining us tonight. And that video ended a little abruptly, but we completely exhausted my technological capabilities to put that together, so appreciate your patience. That's what we have for you tonight. Again, thank you for joining us. We're glad we could be together to celebrate my mother's life. We'd like to suggest that you spend some time with your family tonight, perhaps enjoy a glass of Sauvignon Blanc and share some memories among yourself. We would love to hear from any of you with any other ideas. It's always pleasant to hear people's favorite memories of my mother. So thank you very much for joining us. Have a good evening.